Okay, good afternoon to all. Hope my previous session was helpful to all in improving your knowledge up to some level. So to my today's session is cyber forensics principles. So in the from past few days you might be going through different cyber different details related to cyber threats and how to defend what happened? Somebody raised hand. So you may be going through different threats which are happening nowadays, and how to mitigate those threats using different technologies and different techniques. Come to the next part, cyber forensics. So here, so after cyber threat, what next? That is the thing we have to think definitely, right? So as per the laws available in any country, definitely the people involved in the threats or involved in crimes, definitely they have to bring to responding law agencies, definitely. So they had to bring them to law rules and all, right? So definitely for that we must be prepared. Actually every time the person who did the crime, that is who is the culprit, definitely he will try to defend. So we have to prove that he did the crime. We have to prove that he did the crime, right? So many wings are available in police department, right? So before I think 15 or 20 years, the type of crimes and the police department equipped with the tools for resolving the crime details and all was entirely different as compared to today's scenarios. The people doing crime were improved a lot, and they had changed the platforms for doing the crimes. In the same manner, the technology, that means the departments who are working in this area, also must need to be equipped with more technology and more tools to crack the threats, to crack the crimes. So after threat happened, definitely we had to do some forensics, right? So then only the details about the threat we are able to get, and that those details we had to submit before the respective agencies, like example court. So my concentration in our my target in this this is my plan for this session. I'd like to give few details about the cyber crimes and what are the different cyber forensics steps and some live forensic related information. So here if you see, cyber crime. Okay, so already gone through different threats through previous modules. Okay, so in different styles threats were happening. People are doing threat crimes by sitting remotely. So it's very challenging job to forensic this type of activities. So whatever the unlawful acts the people are committing, either sitting at the same computer or sitting remotely, we must need to crack the details and present those details in a proper manner. So here different type of crimes people will be doing, right? So they may be sitting at the same computer where the computer is involved in the crime, or they remotely they may be operating the crime through different tools, right? So already you know different like viruses, worms, simply people are putting the data to the targeted machines, and they will trigger the they will trigger their worms or malwares and different things based on some another activity, right? So for example, most of the packages you are installing, third party packages or something, so most of the people while installing, they don't have much interest to go through what all files are coming through that package. So a lot of files will be deployed into our system. We don't know exactly whether all those files are really the package file, the files required for that package, or simply they are coming. Somebody messaged, is there any issue with my voice, please? Yashwant Prabhu, your voice, something. Okay, is there any distress to all actually? Connected to proper network today? Okay. Today I got feedback like my voice is somewhat like less slow, less.
Sir, voice says. Hello.
Hello.
Sir, I think your mic is very far. I think you can. Yes.
Okay, now it is okay, sir.
It's okay. I think a little bit loudly you have to speak, sir. That's it.
Okay, sir. So the cyber crimes will be happening like by sitting directly at the computer, or by using that computer operated from remote sites. Okay, so this type of viruses, software, different type of worms and all will be coming down into our systems, right? So while installing third party software, a lot of files will be coming inside our system. Okay, so for example, if you take the JavaScript files and all, so when we use that one of the JavaScript file, it may be calling another file, and that file may be a problematic one. And once if it trigger that file, maybe it may be create the issues to our system. So like that, when you're installing third party packages and all, so definitely there is a lot of chances. There were a lot of chances for getting threats inside to our computers, right? So like this, different type of crimes will be happening nowadays in different styles. Okay, base point is that crime, we cannot say that simply by sitting at the same system, crime may be happen, but remotely also. Already you know from past few sessions. Okay. So let us say some cyber crimes. So here you have some hacking, right? At level 2 and level 3, a lot of threats which are possible. You got details from previous sessions, right? and different technologies for like AI systems and ML systems, like different systems available for us for mitigating those things, right? So if you see different type of cyber crimes here, hacking, right, fraud and identity thefts will be happening, right? Like different pedophilic rings, so you know that related to child abuse and child related things and all, defamation. Okay, so simply you are using the image of one person and simply posting to Facebook itself will be a crime, definitely. So once if they report the respective persons who did that operation, must need to be punished. Must need to be punished. Okay, defamation. So everything when you are working or when you are using public networks or social engineering sites, everything you must need to be careful. Even that means so definitely everyone must need to know about the IT acts related to that countries. So IT Act available in our country may not be same as like the IT Act, IT related acts in other countries. Okay, so wherever you are, you must be thorough with this crime IT Act related information and all. Okay? So these are the different the crimes which are happening and happened earlier, like credit card cloning and all. You may know that. So simply nowadays, most of the people are getting calls and they will be telling like, we are from bank and we are from a respective credit card agency and you got some issue with the credit card and all. Please tell PIN numbers or some CVV numbers and all. Like that, a lot of calls are coming, right? So most of, in different styles, people are trying to do the crimes. Even in these days, educated people also were coming into this type of cheating activities, and they got involved, and they, at the same time they got issues from the other people by losing the money and all. Okay, so this type of credit card related crimes are happening nowadays where financial related things are involved. Okay, like software piracy is also a crime actually. Okay, most of the people don't care about this piracy and all, but it is also a important thing we have to target. So if you see here, what are the different menaces we have to consider? Check it up. So many cyber criminals than cyber cops, right? Most of nowadays, most of the training institutes are there and most of the people are working in developing the tools for dealing with the cyber crimes. Still, this manpower is very less as compared to the cyber criminals. Okay, so definitely it is our requirement to improve the manpower in this cyber crime checking related activities. So criminals will feel safe, definitely, committing crimes from the privacy of their own homes, right? So in the previous session, I told you, like, most of the criminals are staying behind the firewalls. Okay, so firewall is hiding the details of the actual networks, and they're enjoying the crimes. So most of the tools are available to crack the networks and all. Still, most of the criminals are not, we are not able to bring them to the court of law actually. Okay, so due to a lot of advanced technologies these criminals are using. So in the same manner, the people who are working in respective departments must need to be equipped with advanced technologies. So, for example, if you take a Kali Linux, So this Kali contain lot of tools actually, right? For ethical for penetration testings, for forensic operations, lot of tools are available. So as it is a free one, and most of the people are simply sitting at home and trying to download that and use the tools, and they are becoming masters in hacking. So if they can use it for good purposes, for ethical operations, it's a conversion. But most of the people, definitely they will cross the line from ethical hacking to the illegal activities at some point of time. Okay, so the most cyber criminals are becoming increased day by day. This rate of increase is not happening in actual departments who are dealing with the cyber crimes and all. Okay, somebody given message something like that. Like, okay, any forensic software tool? Okay, we can come to this point slowly. I'll give you a few details about tools and all. Okay, like a lot of different challenges are faced by the law enforcement agencies and also the police departments, those who are working in this area. Okay. Almost every person know about court of law and all. So courts cannot agree the points which are projected by lawyers or projected by police department blindly. So they will observe the points projected by respective people in different directions. So judges from the court and all, if they are not able to, if they don't know much knowledge in technology, definitely they will project the different type of points which were asked just like kids. So how our kids will ask us questions, no? So like that, definitely judges will ask if they don't have the much knowledge in technology. But it may be seems like that point may be very silly or a very simple thing when the technical people hear that will come to that point actually. But still, the people, those who are involved in resolving this information about the crime, must need to project the authenticated details to convince the court. So that is a place where this cyber forensic tools will come into the picture, and that information provided by different cyber forensic departments must be convincible to court of law. Must be convincible to court of law, definitely. Okay. Otherwise, the departments who are involved in this resolving the crime, they are going to lose the. They're going to lose the play. Okay, so criminals are going to win the play. Okay, so it is our responsibility. Technically, we must need to strengthen the teams, those who are working in this area. Okay, so more nowadays, if you see nowadays, most of the law enforcement departments and police departments. Are recruiting people or already available people. They are separating two teams and giving training to technical areas, especially to resolve the cybercrime related informations. So come to the next one, digital evidence. So if you see, for example, some accident happened on road. So information related to that accident will be captured by the police department in different way, right? So no other people could be allowed to enter into that place where the accident happened, right? So in different way, definitely they will handle that place. Handle that place. First thing, what they will, that place will be surrounded by some ropes or tax related to the police department to safeguard the place. To safeguard the place. Okay, why they have to safeguard is that if it is not safeguarded like that, people simply enter and there is a chance of losing evidences from that place. So first place or at first sight, the police department will try to get all the details from the scene. From the scene. Example, accident or some crime occurred scene, place or something else. So if some crime happened at some building, at some room in a house, so definitely they will try to grasp every small information from that scene, from that scene of crime. Okay, so these are general ways, general type of crimes. Okay, so if you come to the cyber crimes, it is very difficult for us actually. It is very difficult for us to handle the scene of crime. Okay, so what we have to do here in case of cyber crimes? So definitely we have to get all the details from the from that crime scene where the digital devices are involved in the crime. Okay, so in the we have to capture that we have to get the digital device details in a proper or in a proper manner, which is authenticated produce before any agency. Okay, so digital evidence contains a different type of information, right? If you take a computer and some person in a cyber cafe, some person opened a site and did some crime, so in that scene of crime, information could be that website what he visited and what type of activities he did with that computer, lot of different things, right? So properly, if you are not capturing all these details, it may not be safe for more time, right? Time is a very critical point here. With respect to time, immediately we have to capture all the details where there is a chance of losing the details. So all those details we must need to capture properly. That is the main important thing. Okay. Here, different categories of digital evidences could be like, right? Text, audio, images, videos, or different like hard disk and pen drives. A lot of things will be involved in cyber digital this like cyber crimes and all. Okay, so we must need to get the digital evidences in a proper way. Then only our words will stay at the court. Otherwise, we'll get the issue. Okay. Why the digital evidence is required? Right? Definitely, for investigation and analysis purposes, and to produce into the court of law or before any investigation agencies, we need these digital evidences. Okay. So if you come down to digital evidence, different categories could be there. Like most of the, some of the people may be using the phones for committing the crime, computers, or small pen drives or different things, okay? CD drives, and very long back floppy drives, right? Floppies, so a lot of things, okay? A lot of things could be there. Okay, so here like if you see pen drives and all, through pen drive different data will be transferred from one place to another place, or for uploading the data pen drive may be used. Okay, so like this, lot of things could be devices could be there is a possibility of involved actually in the cyber crime and all. Okay. So here we have to capture from the scene of crime, we have to capture all these devices, okay, without losing their property, like without any breakage or such type of things. So here if you see issues in digital evidence is volatile, and extremely fragile and easily tempered, right? Easily tempered. So all these things are very important points about the digital evidence. Here, what is the meaning of volatile memory? You know that already, okay? So when you switch off the power, you're going to lose the details. You're going to lose the details, right? So even, for example, if you take the hard disk, purposefully, there is a chance of tampering the details in the hard disk. So the person who did the crime, if he is a very close person to the investigating officer, so investigating officer itself can do some tampering on the evidences collected from the scene of crime, right? So very long back, the details we are getting from the scene of crime will be entirely different, right? Like what type of things, like knives, okay, such type of things we may be getting from scene of crime, but nowadays it's not like that, okay? So in case of cyber crimes, this tampering of tampering could be possible by inside persons or from outside persons. So outside persons are not allowed to come into the scene of crime due to this reason. So while collecting this devices from the scene of crime, definitely we must need to take a lot of care. Okay. So if anything, this volatile data could be there. If anything, volatile related information, like we need to collect, we have to do that information in a different way. We have to collect that information in a different way, because of simply if you switch off the computer which is involved in the crime, we are going to lose the volatile data. We're going to lose the volatile data, right? So this is the place where live forensics are coming into the picture. Okay. So here, if you see the evidence, characteristics of evidence. So when you have collected something, simply we can stay and say that yes, I had collected these details from the scene of crime. And if you are enjoying that, yes, I am a very good person, I have good knowledge as an investigating officer. Yes, I had collected these details. Whatever I am telling, this is the final point. So all these words cannot work out in the court. So even though if higher DCP level officer is involved in this collection of digital evidences from the scene of crime, the court cannot bother about that. Who are you? But the details has to be provided properly to the court of law, definitely. Okay. So these are the different characters of evidence we have to consider. It must be admissible. Okay. So the data must need to be admissible at any place. So it must be authenticated one. It must be a complete details, and it must be a reliable one. It must be a believable one. Okay. So simply some person told that, like, I went to that investigating officer is telling that I went to cyber scene of crime, and he is doing some crime using computer, and he is going to present a knife in the court. Okay, so that much difference must not be come. I had given only example. Okay, so that much difference in getting the evidence, must not be there. Okay, so the evidences whatever you are collecting must be complete. Okay, right? Complete in the sense that a good example is for example, a person while he is doing the crime, a pen drive is involved. A pen drive is involved. Okay. So while collecting, at that time, if you lose that properties of that device, we are not able to grasp the details from that device. Okay. So definitely, while getting that devices from the scene of crime, we must need to take the care that from our hands, we are not going to lose the properties of the devices. Properties of that devices. Okay. So I already given you the cyber forensics role is a major one in bringing the culprits to the court of law. So definitely, the cyber forensic people has to provide the details from the cyber scene of crime, capture the details, and they have to produce them in a proper format which is acceptable to agencies. Okay, that is the main thing. So let us say a few steps for the cyber forensic operations. So come from the bottommost one. Okay. So identification and seizure and hashing. After that, acquisition, authentication, and after that, analysis, presentation, and preservation. Okay. So, okay. So far, let us start with the first one, identification. So that's what I had given you. Scene of crime. That is a main point here. Scene of crime. We have to identify the scene of crime, and properly we have to handle that scene of crime. Okay, without losing any details, without any trespassing. Okay. And seizure and hashing. Properly, you have to seize the details, and you have to use the technical details like hashing to make sure that tampering is not going to be happened later. Okay. So whatever you are collecting from scene of crime will be the same. Even you can move that from one place to another place also. Okay. So you know already different hashing algorithms are available. Hashing is the very good techniques for going through the authentication of the data, right? Next one is that acquisition. Next one is the acquisition. Okay. So after getting that, from acquisition to analysis, all these things are going to be happened at the forensics lab. All these things are going to be happened at the forensics lab. So generally, the forensic lab will be located away from the scene of crime, right? Definitely. So from scene of crime, while transporting the details collected, also we have to take care. We have to take care. So after bringing all those things to forensics lab, based on the tools and systems available at the forensics lab, we have to do the next steps. So here, for example, is a computer is there in the scene of crime, and it is in the on state. It is in on state. Okay. And another computer is also involved in the scene of crime, that is in the off state. That is switched off. So these two computers has to be handled in different style or different ways. So if it is a switched off one, then simply you know that where the data is available for, in the computer system. Okay, you can take the hard disk in a proper manner. Most care with respect to tampering or with respect to damage of the device. So we're going to take that and sending it to the forensic lab. Okay, so definitely from the scene of crime, investigating officer could be there. He is the responsible person for doing all these things. He know, he is technically trained, just need to equipped with related equipments for properly getting details from the scene of crime. Okay, so hashing will be applied through using different tools. So acquisition, so this is another step. Acquisition is another step. One of the main point here is that cyber forensic people, it is not that means it is not a better approach to apply the cyber forensic related activities directly on the device collected from the scene of crime. Okay, so later if you can apply directly this all these authentication analysis operations on the device collected from the scene of crime, there is a chance that if this point come to the site of this criminal, he can defend like any way. Like, they did the operation directly on the device. I am not the one. When I did the when I am there at that computer, this is not like this. These people have done something like that. At every time, criminals will try to blame the analytics people, cyber forensics people. So this acquisition step will be applying on the device collected from the scene of crime to get bit-to-bit data, the complete data, okay, bit-to-bit copy from the device with utmost care. Okay, so that is the acquisition. So if hard disk is the one involved in the crime, a bit-to-bit copy could be taken into the new device. Okay, so there is a chance at this time also, there is a chance that we may lose the data from the device collected from the scene of crime, or our data may be written onto the disk. This type of points could be used by the criminal. So to address all these issues between the devices used to acquire the details from the device, some another devices could be placed in between. Okay, between the device of device involved in the crime and to the device we are using for acquiring the details, some more thing we have to use in between these two. Okay, that is the right blockers. Okay, so we're going to use the different in market, different right blockers are available. These right blockers could be connected between these two. This will address all these points. So while collecting the details, definitely we can defend that right blockers are used. Nothing was written onto the disk collected from the scene of crime. So like this, every point we must need to take care to defend at court, okay? So acquisition properly we have to do. Once after getting the data bit to bit into our drives, we're going to go through the authentication steps, and we're going to do the analysis. So from the scene of crime itself, we can collect the hashing data, hash data, and after acquiring also, these hash data must need to match. Hash data must need to match. Then only the authentication step will be success. Otherwise, there is a chance of some mishandling while transporting or while connecting the devices like that, or some tampering may be happened. Conclusion could be there. So hash value could be generated for the throughout the disk at the from the scene of crime, and the same data could be used for authenticating after acquisition. That same hash value could be there for both data. Then only we can say that acquisition was success. Acquisition was success. So here analysis. In case of analysis part, once after getting the copy, that copied data will be used for analysis, and different organizations will be providing different tools for analysis purpose. CDAC is involved for past so many years for developing different tools in this area. Okay. So once after doing this analysis phase, properly we have to do the presentation. That is, the presentation is a major part actually. That means whatever, like for example, whatever the knowledge we have, if you are not able to present it properly, there is no means of question, right? Like like slides, whatever you are preparing, if the slides is not much having data which is not useful, okay, this is one of the best point here. So presentation must be in a proper format, and that must be easily understandable to the law agencies, okay, where this defense will be taken care, and this the defense will be happened. Okay, so presentation must need to be in a proper manner. This presentation must need to contain all the details related to the case in different directions, okay. And that presentation could be signed by the investigating officer and given submitted to the court of law and to the police departments. And the next one is the last one is the preservation. Okay, so once after doing all these things, the original one collected from the scene of crime must need to be preserved in a proper way. Okay, so we don't know whether that case related details will be closed within a month or within a year or after 10 years or 20 years. We can't. Okay, so whenever the court will ask us to produce, definitely we must be in a position to produce the details. So for that we have to use properly the preservation technologies without without damaging that details collected from the scene of crime. Okay, so these are the different steps involved in the cyber forensics operations. You may be asked me that whether all these steps are required or not, or all the organizations whether they are following all these steps. So definitely any organization involved in resolving these crimes, definitely they must need to follow these steps, and they may be follow some more steps also. Even if you are not able to delete even one step, for example authentication, if you remove, we cannot say that the acquired data is same from the same collected from the scene of crime. Okay, so definitely all these steps are minimum ones, and you can apply some more, you can include some more steps between these, okay, and all. If you are not following all these steps properly, we are not able, our words cannot stand, okay, stand tall in the court of law. So if you see cyber forensics different classifications and all. Okay, I told you already traditional forensics, live forensics, and different forensics, network forensics, and the device forensics. So if you take the traditional forensics, that is a normal one. Right? That means the system involved in the crime, which is in the switch off state. So that comes under the traditional forensics, normal forensics way. And a system is involved, a tab is involved, a mobile is involved in the cyber scene of crime, and it is in the on state. That is the such type of things will come under the live forensics. And in the same manner, like disk forensics for floppy drives or something like that, network forensics. So this is one of the major area where this court of law cannot convince very easily. So people will do the crime from sitting somewhere else, somewhere far away. So in the previous session also, I had given you details like network related packet details and all. So network forensics, we are able to do based on the data collected, from the packets or from the log files or something else, right? So this area is very tough one, actually. Tough in the sense that not time to answer, not speaking about the technical way, convincing the people involved in police departments or court or in court, okay, or in court, okay. Okay, so like this, device forensics, different type of devices could be there, right? Some of the people will be using like recording devices in spectacles, something like that. Okay, some of the people devices in buttons or something. So okay, different type of things could be there, okay, which are involved. So anyhow, the way they follow will be same like collecting the data basically. So all are coming. You may be bring all these disk forensics, device forensics, all these into the traditional part itself, no issue. But this dealing with traditional forensics sense that hard disk and all will be a little bit different as compared to the other pen drive or simply storage device or something else. Okay. Like live or in case of live forensics data, definitely this type of volatile information was involved. Okay, right. So the system is in switched on state. Okay. So volatile data includes like this, like current network configurations. Right. Once you switch off that information, we may be lose. Current system date and time. This also will play a major role in case of giving details about when the crime was happened actually. Okay, 100% completely we may not be depends on system time, because of that could be changed by the persons, those who are doing the crime. But this is one of the component which could be useful for us. Okay, and network connections. This is another major thing, right? So all these details we must need to collect from the live systems. Okay, currently open sockets. So what and all applications are listening on the ports. So once if you switch off the system, all these details we may be lose. Once after switching on again, that application may not be the one which is going to listen on the corresponding port while doing the crime, right? So who and all users are logged in. So all these details are very much important for the live forensic operations. So if you come down to the network-based evidences. So in case of network-based evidences and all, mostly if you don't have the packet information collected. In a previous session, I had given you firewalls, software firewalls, or hardware firewalls, or software devices, softwares or hardware devices for collecting the packets traveling and all. Okay, that data can be applied onto the models for learning or detecting the details and all. Okay, so that packet details, if you are capturing and storing, if you have that much infrastructure, they are the good evidence. They are the good evidence for the network-based forensics. Okay, in the same manner, like mostly in case of network-related things, will depends on log file informations. Okay, so IDS logs and monitoring logs or router logs, firewalls or application server logs or authentication server logs. So what are the logs? If the logging mechanism properly, we are maintaining that log files will be much useful for us for analyzing the network related information, network related information. Okay. So digital evidence seizure, while you are entering into the scene of crime, evidence seizure must need to be done in a proper way. Already given that point. Okay, securing premises, and if anything like this, any modems or something else involved in that scene of crime, get the details of all those things before switching off and collecting the device. Get the details and all. So the seizure, the seizing of evidences must need to. Documenting the crime scene also a very important part. Otherwise, the investigating officer will get issue. Okay, investigating officer will get issue. So that investigating officer, he's very much careful in collecting details from the scene of crime. Okay, so he's going to document all those things like photographs, sketches, and everything. There he will use that this hard disk was collected from this place, and like that sketches and everything he will take, and he will take utmost care without like that means even. Most of the people, investigating officer got issues personally also, even though they didn't done any malpractices. So in those who are involving in this activities, the investigating officers are taking much care while documenting the things. Okay. So different types like CPUs, okay, dongles, CDs, memory cards, modems, a lot of things could be collected from the scene of crime, different evidences. Okay. So seizing devices and all could be taken care in a proper way. If you see here, we have one TrueBack. We have one TrueBack tool is there. This TrueBack tool contain having all those devices required. It is just like a bag. It is just like a bag, which contains a lot of tools required for collecting details. Like this, I told you already. Roid blockers and all those things, different devices which are required contain could be there in the TrueBack. We are using in CDAC. Okay. So in case of seizing and all those informations like about the system configurations, media informations, each block and calculates the block cache values. So all those things we have to properly address while collecting the details. So mainly this thing, hashing values will be generated, which must be equal at any time. At any time, otherwise there is a meaning that the devices were tampered. Okay. So come to the last point, like four copies could be made. Here we are following the procedure like we are going to make the copies. That means after acquisition from the device involved in the crime, we are going to make the four copies, and will be given to suspect. One copy will be given to suspect. That means. To avoid the issues that this is not the data from the device collected from the scene of crime to stop the such type of questions from the suspects. Details will be given to suspect and signature will be taken from him. Okay, and one thing will be given to lab and to the court and to the investigating officer. One will be kept with the investigating officer. Anyhow, original one will be preserved according to the directions from the court or the police agencies. So come to the another main point, packaging and transportation. So while packaging the devices involved in the crime and in the transportation, we had to take much care actually, right? Bubble wrap could be used and magnetic media devices and or anti-static bubble wraps could be used for while bringing the devices from the scene of crime. Okay, and while transporting also we had to take care without giving any issues unnecessarily. Here if you see here magnetic devices, magnetic media and all, okay, we're going to use anti-static bubble. Like for example, if you say if you take hard disk could be there, right? So from the scene of crime I got hard disk, and while transporting the hard disk, what type of issues may be arise to get the damages? If you observe this point, a lot of things could be involved in getting that hard disk may be damaged. Like for example, vehicle is going with very speed, so that hard disk was dropped from top position to the floor, so there is a chance of damages, right? And another technical way, can somebody tell, like, is there any chance of losing the data from the hard disk? Just I'll take break for 1 minute for drinking water. Please put in chat, is there any chance of losing the hard disk data by using okay, how it is? Some Upadhyay I had given yes, and how you can lose. Okay, not about the physical damage, and other than the physical damage, is there any other possibility? Like when the with respect to magnetic type of things, something. High power magnets nearer to this hard disk and all, there is a chance actually, not in every cases hard disk, okay, even in the running state actually. Okay, so while transporting or something else, or while dealing with the hard disk and all, this type of magnetic related equipments or this radio transmission things, something like that. So we have to take care to put these original devices away from this type of thing. So we have to use the anti-static bubble wraps while transporting and all. Okay. So authentication we have to do using the hashing things. So for example, I will give you a quick idea about this. Like for example, this is the string, for example, hang him not comma kill him, this is the sentence, hang him not comma kill him. So this is the message that we are getting for this one. In the same document, for example, just if you change the comma from this place to next to him, we are going to get another message digest. Okay, so this much perfect and this much strong this hashing information could be. So for authenticating, different algorithms could be there in doing hashing. So we can use those and generate the hashing informations, which must need to be same, which must need to be same on every copy and original device. So this is only the way how we can define about the correctness or authentication of data in the court of law. So definitely the judges cannot believe all these things. They may be asking questions like this, like that algorithm, how it is correct, whether it is a correct algorithm or not, or you may be tampered the algorithm also. So this type of questions came actually a lot of times. While doing all these process, we must need to take care. Okay. So while collecting details and all, nothing must need to be go from the collecting devices we are using for collecting the details to original devices. There is another one of the main point you must need to take care. Okay. So what this forensic analysis can reveal is another point. What can this forensic analysis can reveal? Okay. So you know already that how the crimes are going on and what type of details could be there in a computer system, right? So using forensic analysis or what are the tools you are using, they must need to get all these details from the hard disk. So we have to write down programs or to we have to develop the tools to collect all these details. So we already know analysis of hard disk, where the details could be stored, where the boot details could be stored, and how the data could be stored onto the hard disk. So at the memory level itself, we have to analyze and we have to collect the details, and we have to show present from the tools, present from the tools. So directly memory level analysis could be required in case of forensic analysis tool development. So while you are seeing this file, or while you are seeing that file extension may be some docx or .pdf, but internal details could be something else. Actually, before that, changing the extension, that extension of the file may be something else. So all those details we are able to grasp from if you observe the memory directly. Okay. So a memory analysis, directly applying analysis on the memory addresses will be the way how the forensic tools need to be developed, definitely. And also in-depth knowledge about this memory organization and all will be the required one. Okay, so a lot of what and all websites or visited files and what and all attempts were taken by these people. So all those things must need to get from this tools. Okay. So another one is that recovery operations also could be possible. I told you at the memory level we had to analyze, so recovery also could be possible. Mostly you know that already, like whatever the file you are deleting, the contents from the memory is not going to be wiped out, right? Content could be there in the memory locations, but links to that file to the memory locations will be cleared, I think, right? So at the memory level, you must need to get good knowledge for developing these things. Okay, slack spaces also could be there, which are the places used by many of the hackers nowadays. Like for example, somewhere around 4 KB is allotted to some file, for example. So that if that file is using only 3 KB, remaining 1 KB could be there. So these hackers are hiding the details in this Slack areas, in this Slack areas. So whenever whenever they are getting connection to their system, they will simply collect the details from the Slack places, and they will try to use attack the systems. So directly the memory related analysis, memory reading, and all those things we have to do in case of analysis operations. So you may be asking me that when you are interacting directly with memory, whether it is a whether it is ethical or not. So what we are doing is that already we are getting the details from the culprit system. So there is no meaning of asking that whether it is ethical one or not. Okay, but simply using the tools and going to some PC, so your neighbor PC or your close ones PC, and collecting details from there and all, you will get all these details. But it is not good. It is not an ethical one. Okay. Okay. So a lot of free tools also there, which will collect, which will get the details of files deleted from the hard disk, which are hidden with another extensions, all those things. Okay. So these are the few things so we have to remember about cyber forensic while doing cyber forensic operations. So if you see here, come to the next one, live forensics. So we had already discussed that live forensics challenges could be there like this, right? We need to get the access to the system, and we have to do the minimum impact on the system, and some tools will leave the footprint and onto the system. So timely evidence acquisition and analysis is an important one. Live system, live forensics, so system which is in on state, switched on. Okay. So now, from the crime scene, we had to collect all these details before it is going to be switched off. Okay. So for collecting that details, definitely we had to get the access to the system, right? Without without putting our tools to run onto the on the system, it is very difficult for us to capture the details in case of live system. If it is a traditional forensic, if it is a dead system, that means switched on, switched off system. So definitely, we are going to copy bit by bit. But in this case, in the live system, we had to collect details from the RAM, which is going to be, which we are going to lose once if system is switched off. Okay. So collect the details from that RAM. Definitely, our application must need to be run onto the system. So our system, our application, while it is running on the system, it must not tamper any other details from the system. So we need to take care that our application has done minimum impact on the running of the system. So in the court of law, definitely this culprit will try to defend that while collecting details, their application has done something. Because of while collecting the details in the running processes, our application name also could be listed, right? In the live system running processes, our application name also could be listed. So once if we come to once if the culprit know the details of the that this application is not something else like that, he can defend by taking this application name. So as an investigating agency or investigator, we must need to take care to minimize the impact on the system, and also all these things has to be noted down and could be provided to the court while presenting our information. So conducting the live forensics could be done with this type of things: a retrieval of volatile data, forensic imaging of live system, analysis of evidence collected. Okay, So in case of dead system, that means in case of switched off system, bit by bit we are copying, right? In the same manner, using different tools, we have to copy information of RAM, okay, and we have to keep it. We have to keep it. So retrieval could be done in a proper manner. So these are the live data already I had given you, like network status, network related things, different shares, share informations, and map drives. And if anyone connected remotely to the system, okay, all those informations could require to collect from the live system. To collect from the live system, okay. So if you see the non-volatile data, so these are the volatile data, right? If you switch off the system, we are going to lose these details. And non-volatile data also will play a main role here, okay? Event logs, registry, and disk. So all these data later also you are able to fetch. Later also you are able to fetch. Because of hard disk copy could be there in our hand, these details we are able to fetch later also, but this data, this live data, we cannot. So properly we have to collect all these details. So here, after coming into the scene of crime, mostly we have to concentrate on the RAM information, right? What is the size of the RAM? This is one of the main point we have to take into consideration. That means if the system have a 4 GB RAM, we must be ready. We must be ready with a disk or device more than that size. Otherwise, it is not possible for us to capture the RAM details from the live system. Okay. So just by taking 2 GB pen drive and taking 4 GB data, it is not possible. Okay, so more than that size, even while taking the copy of the hard disk, we have to be ready with more than the size of that hard disk actually. Okay, so this is the one of the main thing while trying to take the data of the RAM, we must be ready with proper devices. So memory acquisition could be done to some file, okay? For example, if I have pen drive, 8 GB pen drive is there in my hand and 4 GB RAM is there in the system. So I can use that 8 GB pen drive, dump the details of the RAM. You know already different tools are available for us, open source, right? Dump it, MDD, lot of things. Even you can try out with the dump it, you can get all the RAM details from your system. And use the open source tools for analyzing what is happening in your system. So you can dump the data into the file. That file can be used for analysis. A lot of tools are available for us for analyzing the details. Okay, so volatility, this is one of the good open source tool. You can use it for analyzing the details. It will give most of the details of the dump file in the format of a hex, or in the format of in the format which we are able to understand. Okay, so most of the people are excellent or experts in analyzing the hex, data also. Okay, so after the dumping the data, this data we're going to use in analysis. Let us come down to some of the tools for the live forensics operations. We are using a WinLift tool, Windows Live Forensic tool. Okay, mostly most of the tools we have developed will be concentrated on Windows, where more number of attacks are happening. Okay, so WinLift tool we are using for live forensics. In the same manner, like Coffee is there, which was developed by Microsoft. Encase could be there. Okay, so like this, lot of tools are available for us, open source and commercial tools also. I would like to concentrate on WinLift. Okay. Yes, somebody give it. Okay. Cyber forensics. Okay, you can see here cyberforensics.in site is there. This portal was maintained by CDAC Trivandrum. You can get more number of tools. You can get more number of information from the cyberforensics.in. You are able to register into that site, and you can download. You are able to download the tools also. You are able to download the tools also for the trial purposes. For the trial purposes, around 1 month or 2 months, we are giving the tools for the trial. And of that, and also all the features may not be available. So here the process we have to do like this. I'm not telling about tools. What are the tools you are using? The process could be three steps, right? Investigator has to collect the details. So investigator is going to use one device, and he is going to dump the details of system. So this device could be used, okay, to collect the details, right? So first of all, investigator will prepare this device to streamline or to finalize that what type of details we have to collect. Okay, so in WinLift tool, you are able to select. You are able to select what and all details. What and all details we have to collect from the RAM. Okay, so all those things could be generated in the form of DLL files and exe file into the USB drive. First, we'll prepare what and all details to be collected in the form of exe file into the USB drive. So this USB drive will be connected to suspect's machine, and we are going to run the exe file. That exe file will do the operation of getting the volatile data, getting the volatile data and copied to the pen drive, copied to the pen drive. Okay. So here the change coming in the suspect's machine will be, after inserting the pen drive drivers could be detected into the suspect's machine. When this application was run, that process also could be listed out in the running process in the suspect machine. Okay, so these two points will be the change once after inserting our pen drive to the suspect's machine. Okay, so these two points we have to use, and we have to document, and we have to show in the reports to project in the court that this is the impact happened on the suspect's machine while collecting the details. Okay, these two points are important. So after getting details into the pen drive, that pen drive can be taken into the investigator's machine, use the tools, okay, and analyze the details for getting. So totally, investigator first prepare what and all details we need to collect, okay, in the form of exe file into the device. That device can be inserted into the suspect's machine, get the details, and come back to the investigator machine and analyze those details. So this WinLift tool contain all these things. It is available freely in the net. Yes, you can go through. So see here, in this WinLift imager, we are able to collect the details like this. It is up to the user, those who are doing. We can collect the details of running process, network status, system informations. And when you select accordingly, the details will be available here. Okay. Well, based on required information, you can check and collect the details to ESP or external hard disk or something else. Okay. So after starting the process, it will generate exe file. Okay, and collect that exe file when you are running in the suspected machine. It is going to collect all the details. So like this, based on selection, it will acquire details and kept into the pen drive. pen drive. Okay. So this is a Winlift analyzer's home. So here, if you are able to view, just you can go through here. This window will give you in the presentable format all the details collected from the culprits or culprit system users. You are able to get running process. Okay. So these details is it is giving this slide is giving you network connections. What and all there at the time of collecting the details. Okay, so source IP, destination IP, whether listening or established or something else, close weight or listening, something like that. Okay, so like this, lot of details you are able to get. Even you are able to get something like a screenshot also. Somewhere here it is there. While taking there at the time, what is a screenshot? That also you are able to get. Here somewhere it is there. At what and all information we are able to collect, at most we have to collect from the live system. Once it is switched off, we are not going to get it back at any cost. Okay. If you observe services also, you are able to get. Okay. So just you can try. I'm suggesting just you can download and try this Winlift analyzer from the CDAC. This coffee is also there. This also almost following the same procedure. Investigators machine, they will prepare attach that thing to the target machine and get the details. Like this, lot of tools are available. Okay, I'm just giving all of you. The forensic tools are available in Kali Linux also. Okay, so this Kali Linux is one of the good one for penetration testing tools and for forensic tools. Those who are having good interest in this area, this is the first place where you have to explore about the tools and different knowledges. They have more than around 200. A lot of tools are available, and frequently they are using the tools. So most of the people are simply sitting at home and studying these tools and practicing these tools, and they're getting good knowledge into the hacking related activities, and they are using. Most of the people are getting jobs also. Into the organizations. So if you see some of the tools here which are available in the Kali Linux, binwalk, okay, search is specified binary image for executable code and files, and listed some around 10 tools. Bulk extractor could be there. It will extract a lot of details, URL links, email addresses, and something like that. And hash deep tool is there for hashing of files and all. And magic rescue tool is there. It performs the scanning operations. It performs the scanning operations on a blocked device, recovers files deleted or corrupted partitions and all. Magic rescue is a good one. And GUI imager tool, and I use to acquire media for forensic imagery. Just like Winlift acquisition we are doing, this tool we are able to use for acquiring the details. So for applying operations on PDFs, okay, for applying operations on PDFs and all, for going through the extensions, changing the extensions and all, a lot of tools are available in Linux and all, right, for analyzing. So just PDF edit tool and PDF parser, PDF something, a lot of tools are available. Just you can try to explore. Another one is the autopsy is there. It is an all-in-one forensic tool almost. It is a very good one. And you can go through analyzing Linux-related things and all. And, this tool calls the deleted files and media from unallocated spaces and all. Okay. It's a very good tool actually, autopsy. I have a lot of options. I didn't remember that clearly. A lot of options are there. Okay. And img underscore cat tool is like image details simply you can display, okay, onto the console or the console and all. Just you can cat the image details and all. Okay. So like this, lot of tools are available for us freely. If you are you can try to explore for getting good knowledge and use that knowledge for ethical purposes, only. And you cannot go and you cannot go beyond the line of ethical things. Okay. Nowadays, it is not the case like a few so many years back. Now all the departments are having good knowledge, and they are, and you cannot say simply that after doing some crime I am safe, nobody is watching me. But definitely departments will be watching you. Okay, so use the things for the ethical purposes. Okay. Okay, this is from my side, and let us see some of the participants had asked something. Okay, this is my mail ID, jayaram, jayaram @cdac.in, cdac.in. From crime scene, how forensic get unlock the hard drive? How forensic get unlock the hard drive? Unlock in the sense that what do you mean by like in a normal way you can take it, no issue, but you must need to take care without damaging any pins or something else. Okay, otherwise it will become okay. Hard drive and hard drive have also. So police officer got hard drive from crime scene. So how far is it get on? Okay,
voice is not audible.
Okay. Password unlocking tools could be there. Definitely, you are able to unlock it. We have a tool. I didn't correctly remember. We are doing that actually.
Yeah, whatever.
Boss. I'm getting some voice. Forensic tools of Kali Linux will be compatible in BOSS OS. I didn't got this. That means you are planning to use in BOSS OS also?
Sir, this is Balagopalakrishnan. Hello.
Okay, sir. Yeah.
Sir, we are collecting all the evidences and the court has to validate all these evidences, whatever we collected. So how they will validate? Because even though we technically collect all the details, the person from background, he need to understand it, and it has to be validated. So for all whatever that we are making submissions, that that how it is accepted in court of law, the validation aspect, how it will happen.
That is a main challenge actually. In the starting stuff I told you, judges will be having different concerns about this validation of validity of things what are we are presenting. So mostly this judges will be nowadays just in the starting days they cannot convince about this authenticity whatever you are providing actually. Now I think we have started training the judges level also technically, and almost nowadays they are convincing. With respect to hash value, with respect to hash value is the main place we are providing to them in the reports on different copies. That is only the thing we have the choice actually. And they have to agree that actually. And they may be some of the judges are cross checking the technical details whatever we are providing from CDAC by consulting some another forms also about the validity. So almost technical side, every organization will be following hashing technique only, even from US organizations also.
Okay.
Other than those hashing things, nothing, nothing else would be there actually. So most of the judges are convincing on that point nowadays.
Okay. Sir, is there any role of the witnesses, because we are talking about evidence, so is there any role of witness in the form of electronic witnesses? It will play a major role here in that supporting the evidence, or what is the mechanism, sir? Because normally the witnesses will play a major role in normal court of law. Is there any digital witnesses in case of the cyber crimes?
Okay, digital witness, nothing. That witness side is not having major role here actually in cyber side. So
Hello,
data
sir.
whatever we are collecting, data whatever we are collecting. Hello, are you able to hear me?
Hearing you, sir.
There
you
is no much major. There is no much major role for the evidences here. That means major role
for witness. For witness.
Hello.
Yeah.
Witnesses.
Oh, whatever we are presenting, that without validating that, the judges will accept it, or any witness mechanism, it will play a major role. That is my question.
Presenting in the sense that different
no,
departments will be
that,
involved into this one.
Taking snapshots. Yes, not technically. That we are taking snapshots of all the hard disk data and our registry. So logs, all these things we are taking as a evidence for collecting the crime happened. So, but something has to be witnessed. Some people, they need to witness. Yeah, it is the authenticated source that this has happened this time. They have collected these evidences. So by following these process like that, somebody has to witness it. So in court of law, or any system is like that for witnessing the evidence in our
Yes, sir. From the in the crime of scene, not only the investigators, different departments will be involved. Manually they are maintaining all the details, one and all, in all are involved on the devices. And digitally, if you see, the tools we are using from CDAC will be doing bit by bit copy actually. So that means we have the total complete copy in our hand. And also some organizations are there which are insisting on following the procedures, following the procedure, how the organizations has to provide the details. So if you are able to convince them that we are following that step by step, definitely they have to accept it.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
No other question. Cybercrime involve both victim and criminal. Cybercrime involve both. Metadata, yes, metadata also. Okay, these are the different questions I think from chat box.
Sir, one more doubt, sir. Sir, hello.
Yes.
Sir,
when
we are capturing the hard disk and laptop and the others of the crime people, so then we are presenting them as a evidence in court of law, and parallelly we are taking replicating the hard disk data in the police hard drive or any external drive. So for defending, if when we are presenting in court of law, whether the defender, whether they will ask for their system to prove them that the department is presenting a wrong case, they are going with wrong way of showing the evidence. So
breaking, sir, actually your
voice. Forensic department of a police department or like that, any, yes, any chance of that person, the offender, to claim back their the equipments, the laptop or hard disk, to prove that the police department or forensic department,
definitely,
they have done
definitely,
wrong. In that case,
Definitely, definitely, sir,
we will hand
definitely, sir.
over
Yeah,
the
yeah.
hard disk to the lawyers and the forensic persons of the offenders.
Yes, sir.
So,
yes, sir.
What is the mechanism, sir?
Here the thing is that, like that, at the starting I told, I had given, I think, about this one. So here our role is that only cop getting the details in copied into another hard disk. That's all. Rest of the things will be handled by the police department and court. Court will direct. Totally, police department also doesn't have much role in this one. They have to follow the orders of the court. With whom it has to be kept. That means that is the last step, preservation. With whom they have to preserve the details, and who is responsible for this. So all these things will be directed by the court. Directed by the court. So and analysis side and all will be responsibility of the CDAC. That means those organization involving in resolving the cyber crime. Anyhow, we are using the copy of the data only. Original data could be kept somewhere according to the directions of the court. So whenever executive director from CDAC Trivandrum will attend in person, in-personally to court while case is going on. So he is the authenticated person to deliver all these details. Okay, sir.
Any other questions from participant sides?
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Any other questions from participant side? Okay. If no questions are from the participant side, we'll take time. Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks a lot for your informative talk. And once again, thanks for your time and as well as your informative talk.
Hello. Hello, I'm not getting, sir. Can we stop it?
My voice is audible to you, sir, now. Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Sir, is my voice audible to you?
No, it is breaking. Breaking sound. Okay.
Now it's audible, sir.
Now?
Just I want
yes,
to
yes,
see.
Right now it is.
Now my voice is audible.
Okay, sir. So now it is a little bit better. Right?
What about now, sir? Is it audible now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. And so, any questions from participant side?
Yes, sir. There is a question.
Yeah, please ask.
Good afternoon, sir. So how we can connect digital evidence and forensic with reference to Information Technology Act 2000?
We can collect.
How we can connect digital evidence and forensic with reference to Information Technology Act 2000?
Collection of details, right? That is what the question is?
Yes, sir. How it is having a connection with the IT Act?
Hello.
Yes.
Ma'am, if you don't mind, can I, the act will be the major part, the evidences will be the part of that act. Actually, whatever the procedures mentioned in the act, with respect to the IT aspects and the breach of IT aspects, for that everything it will be covered under act. So we need to follow that with the evidences.
Evidence Act also in India, and Section 66 of IT Act talk about the criminal cyber crimes. And
yes.
With reference to the Evidence Act, we generally govern, the court governs with reference to the criminal, the Evidence Procedural Code of India. So,
yes.
So I am only asking about how IT Act is related to digital evidence. I'm not sure.
So the Evidence Act, it has updated to cover the IT Act. So whatever that evidences has to be substantiated to cover any this one. So accordingly, both the things, both the IT Act and Act has been amended. Then the clauses of that both Evidence Act and IT Act, it is matching together as of now. That is my knowledge. So we need to see the act for collecting all the.
See, I'm a law student. I'm a law student. I know about provisions in Evidence Act, but there was some confusion related to IT Act. That is why I asked.
Okay.
IT Act is majorly governing, putting more details on what to do and what not to do, okay, right?
Mm-hmm.
This also, I think, for collecting details also, Act may be having, I don't have correct point at all in that, I didn't go on to this, please.
Okay, if no more questions, then we'll wind up. Jairaman sir, thanks a lot for your time and your work.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
And, thanks a lot for all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Can I exit, sir?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. Thank you. Thanks for the session, Jairaman sir. It was really informative session. Thank you.